The smart person is saying, okay, let's wait, because there's going to be a time here whenever there's going to be a good opportunity to buy. And so when everybody else is running to, you know, the exits, these individuals are sitting back saying, okay, this is my entry point.
You have to have patience.
All right, Bud Casper, certified financial planner here with Dean Barber. We're going to talk about habits of self-made millionaires. You know, you and I have been in this industry for a long, long, long time. I want to just take a step back. You recall back in your younger days in this industry, if somebody had $1 million, that was a big, big deal.
Yeah. Yeah, the question was, how in the world did you get $1 million?
How did you get that? How did you do that? And, you know, when you start off in your career and even into your 30s, you're thinking, how do I get to be a millionaire? Mm-hmm. And the interesting thing is today that we see people on a regular basis that have achieved that millionaire status. And in fact, it's not just a single millionaire. We work with many, many multi-millionaires, you know, $2 to $10 to $15 million. And the interesting thing is that $2 to $10 million person, they don't really consider themselves that wealthy. But when you look at all the studies, if you have $1 million, you are considered high net worth.
Yeah, no doubt about it. You know, when I look at it from the perspective of how people are saving money, and people say, well, I'm doing all my saving through my 401k plan. Well, let's look at that. Let's give some exponential numbers associated with the future growth of that money. Let's see, I'm putting in so much, my company is matching so much, and if I were able to average, and I'm just pulling this out of the air, Dean, 8% per year, and I'm able to do that over the next 25, 30 years that I'm going to be employed, what's my number going to be at that time? Right?
Chances are it's going to be greater than $1 million. If you're maxing out that 401k from day one and you're concentrating on saving. But
wait, my point is it's a worthwhile exercise to go through just to put the concept in your mind that if what we're talking about today, the need of X amount of dollars to be able to retire comfortably, how am I going to get there? Yeah. And that's just one of the features, if you will, associated with that.
So let's dive into these six habits of a self-made millionaire. And then what we'll do is we'll break down each one of these pieces so that we can help people understand what it is that you should be doing in order to achieve your financial freedom. So the first thing you'll notice of the self-made millionaires, they start saving early. Number two, they're fearful when others get greedy, and yet they're greedy when others are fearful. So they understand the capital markets. Mm-hmm. Okay. They've made it a habit of understanding that. They also know that they're going to focus their time controlling what they can control and planning for the things that they can't control. And number four, they understand that taxes are one of the largest wealth eroding factors facing people in the United States. And so they utilize a forward-looking tax plan. Number five, they understand the importance of building generational wealth. And number six, I don't think these are anything in importance of order, but they work with a team of professionals that works on their behalf. Mm-hmm. And so those are the six habits of the self-made millionaire. And you know, we talked really briefly, Bud, about starting to save early. And that's just a whole understanding of compound interest and time.
Right.
You know, those two things together have created more millionaires than people starting up businesses.
It has. The reality is that you're starting up, let's just say you just graduated from college, you meet a young lady or a young man, and you end up getting married, and the first thing you want to do is to get your nest in order, so you're looking at possibly getting a house, you know, but have we saved enough to get a down payment? And so these are things that I'll say get in the way of what you're trying to do in terms of your future need, you know, which is retirement income. But those are the hurdles that people go through, couples go through together to be able to achieve what their goals are associated with it. But understanding the math behind it and the discipline necessary to do that is a sacrifice many times from some of the things you'd like to do pleasure-wise, you know, but it is at least an exercise that needs to be approached.
Right. I would say that saving early also is akin to understanding delayed gratification.
That's a good point. Okay. Yeah, right.
Because it's you don't have to have it all now. You're trying to build something for the future.
Yeah.
And you and I both know that where they save is just as important as that they do save, because in those early years where your tax rate's lower, saving into the Roth portion of your 401k or to the Roth IRA can build tax-free wealth, and therefore eliminating Uncle Sam out of that part of your wealth for a long, long period of time. Let's talk about number two on this list, Bud, being fearful when others are greedy and greedy when others are fearful. Who said that quote? That's a quote from a very, very famous investor.
Warren Buffett.
Exactly right. Exactly right. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I think that quote from Warren Buffett came way back in, it's been a long, long time ago, but it's never more true when you get some wild things happening in the markets. And we can look to the dot-com bubble of the late 90s that burst in the early 2000s. And we can look today at the AI craze and the crazy multiples that a lot of these companies are trading at. And so when people start getting greedy, they're fearful of missing out. And so they just keep piling on where the you know, smart person is saying, okay, let's wait, because there's going to be a time here whenever there's going to be a good opportunity to buy. Mm-hmm. And so when everybody else is running to, you know, the exits, these individuals are sitting back saying, okay, this is my entry point.
Yeah. You have to have patience, is what Mr. Buffett was saying.
No doubt.
I think you remember I had the opportunity to meet him and have a small conversation with him. And he's an incredible man. And he lives by what he basically speaks, you know, from that perspective.
Sure.
And it's worked out beautifully for him. And by the way, if you were fortunate to be part of Berkshire Hathaway's stock, you know, in the earlier years, you don't need to listen to this show.
You became an automatic millionaire.
You did.
All right. Number three on the list of controlling what you can, of the six things or six habits of a self-made millionaire. Sorry, I'm all over the place today. Mm-hmm. Control what you can control and plan what you can't.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that what you can control, I'm going to go back to the genesis of a couple getting together and then going from there. You know what sacrifice you're going to make in terms of, and sacrifice is maybe a wrong word, but, you know, things that you have to put aside for a future, you know, rather than getting the pleasure of what the money represents today. But the reality is it's going to hit you at one point. So the earlier you get started, the better.
No question about it. And look, We'd call this America's Wealth Management Show, but we've focused a lot of our time and attention on those individuals who are facing a pivotal moment in their life, and that is leading up to retirement and then entering into retirement. And there's nothing more important than understanding what you can control and planning what you can't control than those few years leading up to retirement and in retirement. So for that, we've created the Retirement Plan Checklist. Now, this Retirement Plan Checklist is designed to help you understand what you need to do, things that you need to plan for as you plan for that financial independence, that retirement. Get yourself a copy of that Retirement Plan Checklist. But let's move on to number four on our list. And this, to me, is a big one. And we're talking about the six habits of a self-made millionaire. Utilizing a forward-looking tax plan. I've said this many, many times, that taxes are the largest wealth eroding factor facing people in retirement and really over your lifetime. So understanding that and then utilizing the tax code to your advantage is really, really, really important. You can't just ignore taxes because they're going to be a fact of your life as long as you live in the United States and have money or make money. So creating that forward-looking tax plan is critical.
Ideally speaking, you know, if you're employed and you're using the 401k plan as for your future retirement income needs, and if you're able to put money, let's say, aside outside of the 401k, now you're getting the opportunity of getting some tax preference. Why do I say that? Because capital gains versus ordinary income can come into that equation. And that is an eroding factor if you don't do it correctly. However, it's still an adjunct, if you will, to most people's ability to be able to put money aside for their retirement in the 401k. Bringing up what then? Should I be doing a Roth 401k if it's available to me, or the traditional IRA?
Well, and that 401k? In essence, that is tax planning. Tax planning is all about asset location,
right?
Where should I put my money? In what type of tax account, right? Is it a taxable account where the interest and dividends and capital gains are taxable on an annual basis? Is it a tax deferred account like a traditional 401k or a traditional IRA? Or is it a Roth 401k or a Roth IRA? Where and how you put that money in is going to dictate the rules when it comes to getting that money out. So that's why I say that creating a forward-looking tax plan is one of the most critical parts here, because before you put your money into any investment, whether it be the Roth, whether it be the traditional, whether it be the taxable account, whether it be a stock or a bond, or whether it be real estate or whatever the case might be, you need to understand the tax implications when you want to start spending that money.
Yeah, and let me plug in the reality of the amount of debt that our country's in, which means what? At some point, we're going to have to be able to whittle that down, and that means that taxes probably could increase. And if it does, as you said, it's going to erode your ability to get a higher number.
Well, we both know that the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act sunsets at the end of December 2025. So January 2026, every American's going to see an increase in their taxes, whether Congress acts or not.
Yes. And for those who are not initiated with it, that was the Obama tax plan that was upset, if you will, by Trump coming in and lowering the taxes and giving you a unified credit that was much higher.
Yeah, no doubt. So that was all a good thing, and all that changes, and we'll see. We've got, you know, a little over a year and a half for Congress to do something to make that not sunset, but who knows?
Right.
Who knows? One of the things for sure in politics, there's always change. There's always change. When we talk about building generational wealth, which is number five on our list here, you're talking about controlling what passes to the next generation. Now, there's a lot of things we could talk about when it comes to building generational wealth. And a lot of people don't start thinking about that building of generational wealth until they're into their 60s, 70s, maybe, you know, so they don't really think about, okay, this money is going to go down to my kids. It's going to go down to my grandkids. They're more thinking about, how do I get enough money so that I can be financially independent? But here's one of the things that I've noticed, Bud. We said early in the show that if you just start saving early and you utilize the power of compound interest and time, just about everybody has the ability to become a millionaire. Mm-hmm. We call those the millionaire next door. Mm-hmm. And they retire with more money than they ever thought was possible. And even if there's rampant inflation, even if there is a significant illness of one of the spouses or premature death or some other unforeseen circumstances, very rarely will you ever see those types of individuals go broke.
Right.
Right? Because they have always lived below their means. They have always saved. And those type of people will live like they're broke before they allow themselves to go broke.
Yes. And I think inside the Roth 401k, and please visit us at rothaholic.com, because that's something that Dean and I created just to have a little fun with it, but to give you the reality of what tax-free compounding can look like versus what you would have in a traditional type of 401k. And we keep coming back to the 401k because that's the obvious way for people. Let's put it this way. If you didn't have a 401k, then you're really on your own, you know, in terms of having a disciplined approach to how am I going to create income when I decided to retire. So because it's there, you need to know as much about it as you possibly can and actually understand what the results could be over 20, 25, 30 years of feeding money into that, with the understanding that if you do the traditional route, you are going to have tax on that money.
And it's also taxed to the next generation.
It is.
And so the people who are concentrated on building generational wealth understand that when money passes to the next generation, there are tax efficient ways to do that. And then there are very inefficient ways from a tax perspective.
You know, Dean, that's an excellent point that you make, because, you know, I wasn't even thinking in those in that direction, but you're absolutely right. If you're going to have a legacy, why not have that legacy be tax free to whatever extent you can?
This was part of a Northwestern Mutual study, and it talked about the perception of what people need in order to retire. This is a little bit of a digress, but I think it's important here. In 2020, the sample people that were surveyed here, ages, I believe 30 to 65, thought that they needed $951,000 in order to be able to retire comfortably.
Mm-hmm.
All right. That same sample size by 2024 became 1.46 million. So that's an increase of 50% in just 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to sit back and ask yourself, what in the world caused people to think that they need 50% more to retire here in 2024 than they thought they needed back in 2020.
Mm-hmm.
And you and I were talking about this before the show, and I think it's all about inflation.
You're right, it is. You know? Yeah, I just wrote down taxes and inflation. That's the two things that yeah. can really mess it up.
Here's why I think it's inflation. So when you and I and other advisors that are part of Modern Wealth Management, when we put together a retirement analysis in this forward-looking, you know, what's my life going to look like after work? And we try to understand how much money does a person need to be able to live the way that they want to live. We never fell into the trap of using a low inflation rate. Now, we did live in a very low inflationary environment for probably about 15 years.
Pretty close to that.
You know, 15, mm-hmm. maybe even closer to two decades. We had a low inflationary environment. Inflation was pretty benign. And so we saw a lot of people in our industry using a 2 or 2.5% inflation rate to project somebody's ability to retire. People are now saying, well, that's not safe. We need to use a higher inflation rate. Well, we were always using somewhere between 3.5% and 4.5% inflation.
Mm-hmm.
Well, when you increase inflation by just 1% through those retirement years, the amount of money you need to produce that future source of income to keep up with inflation drastically increases. And I believe that's why we're seeing this huge increase from 2020 of people thinking they need $951,000 to retire versus 2024 thinking they need $1.46 million to retire.
Yeah. You know, 3.8% is what we're using today at the time of the show, if you will. Has that changed over the years? Most certainly it has. But again, you have to have the sense of reality. By the way, you should also be utilizing a higher number for health needs. And
yes.
we're on that, we're using about 6.6 right
yeah.
now.
Well, and the whole thing is that you can think about the math part to financial planning, but there's also the art part, right? So I call it the art and the science. The science is just a crunching of the numbers. The art part of it is really understanding how to put that whole thing together. And to me, the art of financial planning is much more important than just the numbers, because yeah. the numbers can be derived at by using a computer or a calculator. The art part of it is the understanding, and really I think it's the life experience, the experience of an individual who has helped people get to and through retirement and has seen just about anything that can be thrown at you, so that not only are you building that plan properly, but you're also taking into consideration all of the what-if scenarios that could occur.
Exactly.
So that you have covered all your bases.
And you want to face those, because without it, you could get trapped or caught in a situation that you weren't prepared for when you had the opportunity by utilizing a professional planner to be able to recognize those hurdles that you're going to have in life.
We talked here a few weeks ago, Bud, here on America's Wealth Management Show, about what people expect from a financial advisor. It was a study that Morningstar did. And I don't know if you recall that show or not, but that listed off several things that people thought were really critical. And as we broke that apart and really delved in deep, what we discovered was that it's really not possible for an advisor, an individual, to do all the things that what that people expect from a financial advisor. So that's number six on our list of the six habits of a self-made millionaire. They actually work with a team of professionals, not just an individual, but a team of professionals that works together on their behalf. Mm-hmm. And so just as an example, your certified financial planner acts as your quarterback. They're the ones that are asking you all the difficult questions. They're ones that are creating this picture of the future, doing the assumptions. And then the CPA gets involved to say, let's not just look at this from a numbers perspective. Let's look at this as how to keep as much money away from Uncle Sam as possible, not just this year, but over your lifetime. Then your chartered financial analyst comes in, the CFA, the one that is spending all day, crunching the numbers and really looking at the investments and understanding the capital markets and the interest rate environment, et cetera, making sure that those investments are doing what they're supposed to do. And then you've got your estate planning professionals that are talking about what happens in the event of incapacity, what happens in the event of, both spouses passing on, how does that money transfer to the next generation? And then you've got your risk management experts that are there as well. So that self-made millionaire, that those six habits, that self-made millionaire has really come to expect that that team of professionals will work collaboratively on their behalf. And, you know, here at Modern Wealth, obviously what we've decided to do is just put all those professionals on one team. Exactly, so that you right. don't have to be, you don't have to be, searching for those individuals and relying on their different schedules to try to collaborate on your behalf. You got one focus.
It's a comprehensive effort by all professionals to be able to get the best result possible, predicated upon the facts that we have to work with at that time. But it is an experience that everyone, in my opinion, should have. And if you haven't, then you need to talk to somebody that can possibly help you.
Well, and if you want to understand how that team of professionals can help you, I'm going to go back to our retirement plan checklist, bud, because in this retirement plan checklist, there are questions that are going to involve all of those professionals. And once you understand the complexity of it, you'll soon understand why you can't just rely on one individual to make it all happen. Get yourself a copy of that retirement plan checklist. We're all about education here on America's Wealth Management Show. We hope that this has helped you. Obviously, in just a few short minutes, we can't do all the educating that we need to do. So I encourage you to reach out and get a conversation started with our team of professionals. We appreciate you joining us here on America's Wealth Management Show. Until next time, everybody stay healthy and stay safe.
The views expressed represent the opinion of Modern Wealth Management, LLC, an SEC-registered investment advisor. Information provided is for illustrative purposes only and does not constitute investment, tax, or legal advice. Modern Wealth Management does not accept any liability for the use of the information discussed. Consult with a qualified financial, legal, or tax professional prior to taking any action.